inviting me and for this very kind introduction. And thank you, Gianluca, for inviting me. So, yes, I'm starting with this. If I'm speaking too fast, which I have a tendency to do, please tell me. Yes, so the signs buried in Tomb UJ and early power, and you see that I'm using the term signs, not writing, because this is the whole question. So, by way of a short introduction, here you have the site of Abydos, and you have Umel Kab in the low desert, and here you have close up on Umel Kab. On the bottom you have the so-called Cemetery B, which is a royal tomb of the first dynasty, stretching all the way back to, in fact, the late so-called Dynasty Zero, so Aha, Narmer, and then Irihor. And on top of it you have so-called Cemetery U, which is older and stretches all the way to Nagada 1 C or D. You see that among the various tombs in Cemetery U, there are some that are not just excavated but brick-lined. Among brick-lined tombs, you see that some of them have more than just one chamber. And here in the middle, you see this one, which is the largest with the most number of chambers, and that is the famous tomb UG, which you have here again fully excavated. With a lot of goods inside, where have been plundered, still numerous vessels, as well as various items that are lexical of power. So there's a scepter, there's also on top this object in obsidian. Obsidian is, of course, hard to work and it has to be gotten from far away. Nails in gold, as well as some ivory sticks that are interpreted by the excavator as gaming sticks, maybe. Anyhow, we are here in the domain of the tomb of a ruler. And the tomb in this multi-chambered layout has been interpreted by the excavator as a miniature palace. So that's a proposal for reconstruction. Now, the reason why this is so famous is, of course, because it includes a number of sign-bearing artifacts, some of which are traditionally interpreted as the earliest Egyptian writing. So to begin with, you have seals, which correspond to, that is, you have no seals, ceilings, which correspond to five seals. On the right, you have the five reconstructed or partially reconstructable seals. Then there's a second type of sign-bearing artifacts, and these are large, wavy handle jars with inscriptions painted on ink or charcoal. That's what they look like. And these are some of the most common visual forms on these wavy handle jars. And then you have a third type of sign-bearing artifacts, which are these small incised bone tanks. These are really small, 2 centimeters. There are about 200 of them. Typically have two signs, sometimes one, sometimes three, very rarely four. That amounts for a total of 60 visual forms on these 200 artifacts, and it also includes, you see it on the lower right, numerical notations. So what we have in terms of sign-bearing artifacts in Tomb UG is really an assemblage of three different types of sign-bearing artifacts. The assemblage is important in itself. And the traditional interpretation of this is that the tags are writing that is to be read. For example, this one is traditionally read as Ba and Set, according to what these forms would later be in hieroglyphic writing, and therefore as a phonetic spelling of the Baset or Bastis. Or similarly for the second one, She and Hor, and She, or is it an estate, is it a palace, whatever, the estate, the palace of Horus, maybe. And the second part of this communis opinio is that this is writing, and more specifically, writing with a utilitarian, that is, administrative function. So the reasons for this, I do the two parts separately, beginning with the idea that this should be writing. Well, first, it looks like writing, and even hieroglyphic writing. So this looks like is very important. I'm going to come back to that later on. But intuitively, it looks like Egyptian writing. Also, it responds to the cipher. And that is, if you take, for example, this tag, you have the elephant standing atop the mountain, and that resembles in the latest spelling of elephantine, where you have these two same signs, plus some additional phonetic elements. So it seems that we can decipher it. And the third reason is that it displays a certain number of systemic features, or it allegedly displays, of course, a certain number of systemic features of writing, and more specifically later Egyptian writing. So very briefly, there are some signs that stand for a word or a name of a place or a shrine, so that's logography. For example, here, perhaps Jebaut, the sanctuary in Budo. Then, if we take this bar instead of standing for Bubastis, we have phoneticism. Then, if we take this as a spelling of for Elephantine, well, the hills would be like a semantic determinative or classifier. Then, well, componentiality of spelling, it simply means that there are, for a given word or name, the spelling consists in more than just one sign, but in two signs in some cases. So, in the case of Ba, set, or Abu, and the determinative. And finally, we would have what technically could be called syntagmatic combinations of words, so if the reading is correct, she and the estate or whatever of false. So it is supposed to be writing and to have all the fundamental systemic structural features of later Egyptian writing and writing. And the second part of the traditional hypothesis is that it is administrative in function, and to make the argument short, first you see that there is these little holes on the tags, so they are what little strings, so the tags were attached to something, probably boxes containing things, maybe cloths, luxury cloths. Also, you have some numerical notations which very much look like administrative in function. And then this all reminds us of what we have in roughly the same period in southern Mesopotamia, in Uruk, where you have also the earliest signs of writing associated with numerical notation. So top left is a very simple one, then bottom left more complex, and on the right you have the massive urbanization in Uruk at this time. So these are the reasons why it should be writing specifically the earliest Egyptian writing with an administrative utilitarian function. And if we stop here, the argument seems pretty compelling, so much so that well, it has been essentially accepted by everyone since 1987, the publication of 2UJ by Günter Dreyer, and challenged only very recently. And I think one of what I just said is wrong. So let me tell you why. I begin first with this issue that this should be administrative in function. If you look at the tags more in detail, you see that they are inside, yes, but then they are additionally filled with paste. So if the function were to be only administrative, this would be rather redundant. If you have the tags inside, you have a form, the information is given, why additionally fill it with paste? I go so far that even on the right, you see the tag with the numerical notation itself filled with paste. In other words, there's a two-step procedure of material production that speaks to the fact that there should be something more here than just conveying information. The materiality of the object is important in itself. And in a certain sense, I'm jumping over centuries, this might even be compared with this panel from the tomb of Metternat, now housed at the Oriental Institute Museum in Chicago, with the hieroglyphs filled with paste. Of course, there's no direct continuity between these two things, but what it illustrates nicely, I believe, is that there's some curiosity in this materiality, and similarly in the UJ tags. If we look now at the way we handled jars, on the left you have one of these signs, and if the function of this was simply to indicate information in the context of tracking goods, provenances, etc., one would wonder why there is about 150 strokes to make up this sign. In other words, the details of the internal resolution here is so high that quite probably something else is at stake. So here again, there's a material investment in the science that is much too high if this were only administered. Also, if you look at the picture on the right with this completely preserved vessel, you see that this form is, well, it's large, it's 15-20 centimeters high, and it's very weird if this were administrative. If it were administrative, you would expect something small like this. And it is fitted to the body of the vessel. So it is fitted to the body of the vessel in a way that it induces a frontal seeing. It is meant, in other words, to be displayed the object as such. So that again speaks against any utilitarian function, and well, for something else to which I go back to later. Let me now turn to the first part of the hypothesis, namely that this should be in writing at all. So how this traditionally works, you have, for example, this tag. I take the same example again. There's an elephant sitting atop, standing atop a mountain. And then you compare it with a spelling that is attested in historical times, and you say, well, we can actually read it. Hence Abu Elephantine. So I'm putting in parentheses some references. It's not to be pedantic, but to express two things. The first one is, as you see, these references are about 1,000 years later. So it is methodologically extremely dangerous to begin with. And the other thing I want to hint at here is that the method is actually a basically phylogenetic, traditional phylogenetic method of decipherment. And nothing guarantees that the traditional phylogenetic method would actually apply here in the late 4th millennium. In other words, quoting references in German text and Bokon in one is potentially irrelevant. Now, the problem with all this is, here you have the exact same visual form. An elephant standing atop a mountain range. That, however, comes from the Wadi Magar, which is a site in the Kenna Valley. So it's located between Abydos in the western desert between Abydos, between Luxor, Thebes, and Dendera. It is far away from the Nile Valley, and especially it has no meaningful connection to Elephantine. But if you have this very same combination of signs, and the Kenna band that directly tells you that maybe in the German case it's Elephantine, well, fair enough, but not in the late 4th millennium. In addition, you can see that it stands atop a bark, a boat, so quite clearly it has to do with symbolism of royal power of some sort. What more precisely, I don't know, nobody knows. But it is an expression of royal power of some sort, and not a name of a place like Elephantine. In other words, that directly demonstrates that the traditional reading is simply wrong. Taking another example, you have this one, which is has been proposed to read first with the J, the snake phonetically, and then the mountain, to stand for Zhu Mountain. And here there's a series of problems. The first one is, well, why do you need a phonetic complement for Zhu Mountain? Even in historical times, there is none. And especially if there's so few signs and words, you don't need it. You need it even less. Second, if you look at variants of this this combination, you see that it's actually a stroke across the snake, and that stroke connects the snake to the mountain. In other words, these are not two different signs, and they are monogram, they are one single visual form. So you cannot read it separately as J plus mountain. It is one thing, whatever that thing is. What that thing is, I don't know. I think nobody knows, but certainly it compares in structural terms to the elephant, another prestigious animal being, standing atop also with mountains. So it's certainly not Zhu Mountain, it is something, who knows. So here again, the reading is wrong, and lastly, Bastet, so that is again based on the cipherment compared with the kingdom material, Bastet, Bubastet. But here the problem is, first, if you look at other inscriptions that could be names of places or shrines in Tumu J, they are all realized by a single sign, not by a combination of two signs. And that is probably relevant because these visual forms have some strong symbolic or emblematic value, it's very clear in the one to the right with Jebel, maybe similarly in the one to the left, which is often associated with Nephilim, maybe, we don't know. So to have here a spelling that would consist in two signs, both phonetic, that would be very unique within, internally to the UJ material. But there is more to it. If you look at these other tags, you also have the same word, the Jabiru, which is combined with a series of other signs. The one to the left, that would be the Min emblem, the second one that would be the Bat emblem of the later times, 7th nome of Upper Egypt. Then you have something which is not very clear, and then you have something which is not very clear either. But quite clearly, what we have here is a system of combination between Jabiru that combines with X, Y, Z, etc. And therefore, the same thing for the Alej Basset, which is not Basset, but Jabiru plus Seed, and what Seed is, I don't know. So, the thing is that all the readings that have been proposed, and these are the ones that have been proposed, are actually wrong. And more specifically, all the cases of phonetic elements that have been proposed are in readings that are wrong. The cases of determinatives are also wrong. There is no componentiality, meaning that there is no spelling of places or words that consist of two signs. Whenever there is a sign standing for a place, it's just one sign. And therefore, when you have something here, the one on the top, maybe it's Jebel, the sanctuary in Buto, it's even possible. It's probable. But do we have here an emblem that is a symbolic representation of the sanctuary, or do we have a sign of writing? Well, we can only decide if, in the same corpus of signs, we actually have signs that are signs of writing, but we don't have them. So here we don't know it's a sign of writing. In other words, there's no evidence, actually, that this is writing at all. Now, one question one might ask is, or why did it go wrong? And that is not just an academic exercise, it's quite interesting to do, because it is an exercise in self-reflection on how we do things in Egyptology. So, since we're all striving towards a self-aware practices in Egyptology, why not do it here? Well, the first thing has to do with this issue of decipherment. So, the very first point I already mentioned, there's this issue of methodology. You have a continuity in visual forms with certain, between UJ and certain forms that would later be signs of writing in hieroglyphs. But this formal visual continuity does not make sure that there is any continuity in values. So, here, it's just an urge to be very cautious. The second point is it looks like writing, and that is very true, and I'm going to develop that later on in this talk. But the fact that it looks like writing is in itself not sufficient to call it writing. So there's a distinction to be made. And then there's a third point, what I would like to call an ethic of decipherment. Let's not forget that our field, like Assyriology, by the way, has been born out of an act of decipherment. So Champollion, but also Botafenerolitz, and so on. Without this initial act of decipherment, we wouldn't be here, very simply. And still today, if you're working on a difficult hieratic or demotic text, you might still be in some way in deciphering. So this idea of deciphering is very strongly entrenched in the fundamentals of our field, and therefore when people were confronted in the mid-80s with these signs that looked like writing, the first almost intuitive step was to try it and decipher. And only later on, 20 years later on, it might be much easier for me to say, hold on, maybe it's not a matter of decipherment in the first place. So this second thing is that the artifacts have been largely dematerialized, and that it's part of the general tendency of Egyptology to dematerialize the artifacts. It's probably to do with the fact that we ourselves live in a written culture in which writing is ideologically conceived as ideally transparent to the meaning it stands for, to what it represents, to what it substitutes for, which means everything it substitutes for, and writing in itself has no materiality. Now, of course, in our world it's not true, but that is the sort of implicit ideological underpinning of it. And I think it's clear that for UJ, like, by the way, for many other artifacts of ancient Egypt in later times, the materiality is an important part of what kind of meanings they convey, and that therefore, well, we need to rematerialize them. And then there's a third one, that is this idea that if you have a territorial state, like begins to be the case in late 4th millennium Egypt, resources and territory needs to be controlled somehow, hence you need administration, hence you need writing. So the first point here is maybe what's supposed to call the Memphite bias. So here you have certain representations in mid later 3rd millennium that very strongly emphasize writing and also writing in relation to administration. But of course, if we look at this in more details, firstly, this is Memphis, not necessarily the whole country. Second, all of these are elite representations, which in itself means that if the elite wants to emphasize this, the reality might have been actually different, because if they were writing all over the place, writing would not have been so prestigious. And thirdly, if you look at Setka, where he was the son of the king, Hesira was probably number two of the state of his own time, or very high up official anyway. So these are ideological representations that do not imply that they were writing all over the place in the mid-late 3rd millennium. And getting back to UJ, UJ is 1,000 years earlier anyway. The second thing is what has been called a civilizational package. So it goes back to the British archaeologist Gordon Child. Well, so it's a package that says that essentially you have a simultaneous evolution, a co-evolution of increased social complexity going hand in hand with the process of urbanization, going hand in hand with the trajectory towards statehood, implying control, implying rising. And the problem with this is that this is to a large degree true in the case of southern Mesopotamia, or four. And that based on what form Mesopotamia, it has been overgeneralized. And it's this package, while there are various parts of this package present in other parts of the world, not the whole package, and anyway, this is basically an overgeneralization of southern Mesopotamia. And the last point is so-called Oriental despotism. So I put down some names because there's a long intellectual genealogy to that. Goes back to Herodot, writing in the context of a confrontation that was also casual with the Persian Empire, and taken up by Voltaire, Marx, and notably Rietvogel, who wrote, put forward the thesis that early Oriental civilizations, be it Mesopotamia or Egypt, were born in riverine environments, that there needed to be a control of irrigation to generate surplus, hence control, hence administration, hence the bureaucratic state. And that is very wrong. For example, just to say this, in southern Mesopotamia, the irrigation work that were mostly carried out in Sassanid times, so 4,000 years later than the period we are interested in. But nonetheless, this idea of the Oriental despotism has found its way into the social sciences and is still implicitly present in Egyptology as well. Implicitly, the idea that once the state emerges, when it becomes a territorial state, you need some kind of very tight control. And if you look at the genealogy of these authors, it's really an ideological projection of how the West sees the East at various times across history, ever since Herodot. So I think it's a combination of all these various elements that has led to the traditional hypothesis and made it seem so natural and so widely accepted. So now I would like to propose something else. And first, that's really a point zero. It's just background, some context on late 4th millennium Egypt. If you look at people in space, there's a fairly low population density and it's very unequally distributed across the country. There are cities in a few places, but still a sizable amount of people who move. And the economic basis of early power is for sure a appropriation of some resources by force, probably oil domains for production. There are attempts of controlling certain aspects of the long distance flow of goods. But there is nothing like full control of a territory. And also, you may note that on all these points, late post millennium Egypt is different from late post millennium southern Mesopotamia. So that what happens in southern Mesopotamia, the civilizational package that I alluded to before, cannot be transposed onto contemporaneous Egypt. Now, speaking of this territorial expansion and the idea that certain authors almost put down in writing axiomatically that there is a territorial state, hence it needs to be controlled, there are certain number of distinctions to be made. First, territorial extension does not mean the elimination of local forms of power, nor the direct control of economic activities on a local level. Also, territorial expansion does not mean territorial integration, and integration is actually a very gradual process that will take probably like 1.5 millennia to be completed. So that speaks against the all-controlling bureaucratic state in the third millennium. We saw the length of bias, but also speaks against the necessity of a written administration for the burgeoning state at the times of UJ. Now, speaking of administration or control, this can, if I'm speaking in general terms, be written or non-written. So what, for example, Juan Carlos Moreno García is developing now is that there is various ways of informal administration with patronage, kinship. In addition, there are various other means than writing to put down some visual marks that record information, like tallying, part marks, and ceilings. And finally, when there is written administration, and here I'm speaking of Egypt, but I think one can transpose that to the country I am now living in, France, written administration is not necessarily bound to be terribly efficient. It can be completely counter-efficient, but part of the raison d'etre of written administration is also that thereby the state affirms itself. That is, in other words, there is a self-asserting ideological component to written administration that goes well beyond, and sometimes against, actual informational efficiency. So speaking of tallying, pot marks, and ceilings, I'll give you some examples here. In the later third millennium, from Balat, so in the oasis, a place where papyrus was scarce, you have various types of marks. On the left, you have ceiling top right. Then middle right, you have tallies, basically. All of these are more informal, or at least non-written ways of recording information. You can have information tracking through seals. So here's the famous case of Aslan Tepe, southern Turkey, first half of the fourth millennium, where there has been a four-tier hierarchy of responsibility reconstructed. Maybe it's not so important whether the four-tier hierarchy actually works, but the very idea that there can be such a differentiation without using Bramkin is certainly convincing. And getting back to Egypt in the later fourth millennium, there's some evidence for ceiling practices, for example, in the Nagata South town or in Adayim. All of this non-written. So the point here is that in the late fourth millennium, there is no Egyptian state that necessarily needed much written administration or much administration at all. And even if there was some administration, there were various means to do that without actually having writing to do so. So that was sort of the background. Now, moving towards an alternative interpretation, the first point is that we need to look at a closer look at the visuality of the marks themselves. So here we have a list. Let me walk you through this. So if we look at this, the first observation is that there is a compositionality, meaning that there is two visual forms that are composed with one another in ways that make no sense in terms of direct representation. I mean, obviously, a bird does not sit atop an elephant, right? So that is the compositionality. Also, there's the calibration of relative sizes. In real world, a bird is much smaller than an elephant. here, in terms of visual forms, they are calibrated with one another to have the same sounds. And these are, of course, features of what data writing would have inside. But these are features that are not exclusive to writing. So if I take this block inscription tableau from Watanabe again, you have the exact same features. And while obviously an elephant cannot sit atop mountains which would themselves be installed in a boat, and in terms of relative sizes, it's actually different sizes, and then representation they're all the same. So there's a certain number of things happening semiotically in fourth millennium that would lead to writing, but that are not exclusive to writing. Now, of course, the difference between the UJ times and the tableau like the Wadi Magar is that in the UJ times you have a miniaturization, so they're really 2 centimeters high. There's also the matter of orientation. You see that the signs on the times are consistently oriented either in one direction or in the other direction. But it's another form of conventionalization. And in the ink inscription, similarly, it has been noted that the scorpions all face to the right on all vessels. And then you have a regimentation of forms. It simply means that these are scorpions, there's some variation, but there's really a stabilized form. So 3, 4, and 5 are additional features of what like writing will later be. But here again, they are not exclusive to the UJ material, because if you look at the Abu Zaidan knife angle, you have the exact same. You have the miniaturization, you have the orientation, which is consistent, and you have the regimentation of forms. Now, there's a difference between this UJ count and the Abu Zaidan knife handle, and that is that in the UJ material, we don't have these serial arrangements, these rows of things. So that makes it look more like writing than the Abu Zaidan knife handle. And you have syntagmatics, meaning you have A and B that can be combined simply, and most importantly, paradigmatics. So, for example, you have the elephant that can be combined with different things, or you have the snake atop the mountain that can be combined with two things, or you have, as we have already seen, the bird that can be combined with a series of different things. Well, that's what in structural linguistics one would call the paradigmatic axis. And that is very typical for writing. So at this point, we have moved away from simply visual representations like the Abu Zaidan knife handle or rock art. But is this really exclusive to writing? In other words, is this a proof that this is writing, like people have generally assumed? In fact, no, because if you look at spot marks, they have the exact same features. They are syntagmatics, they are paradigmatics, and they are not writing. So that is the point where I need to introduce the idea of non-linguistic marking systems. So writing is a marking system. It's a set of stable visual marks that can be combined with one another. But it's just one type of marking systems. It belongs to a broader category of marking systems, some of which, in fact, most of which are non-linguistic. We'll begin first with a few examples. Spot marks, of course, the earlier ones, the later ones. More generally, identity marks, the identity marks in Deir al-Medina that are currently being studied notably by Lyon, Ben Hari, or elsewhere, for example, Mason marks. And that extends well into the contemporary world. For example, the signalization on streets, that's a non-linguistic marking system. So what is a non-linguistic marking system? It's a system of stabilized visual signs, and stabilized according to a whole series of visual properties like the ones we saw before. And that also has not only this individual set of signs, but also certain rules for combining them. But there is, to a non-linguistic marking system, an inherent structural limitation, namely that it does not represent language, and therefore cannot represent the whole set of sentences that one can produce with language. And therefore, a non-linguistic marking system always has a restricted functional scope. For example, with the identity marks in Deir al-Medina, when we can communicate the identity in Deir al-Medina, we cannot do anything else. So what we have in UJ really is a non-linguistic marking system, or more precisely, we have four of them. We have the one on the way we handle genres, We have the one on the times. We have the second one on the times, which is the numerical notations. And you see that the numerical notations and the other signs, they are disjunct sets. You never have numerical tallies and other signs on the same time. And then, speaking of non-linguistic marking systems, of course, the seals are also one. So we have four different non-linguistic marking systems that are all of them doing different functions, which I don't know. But in some sense must have been complementary, otherwise they would have had only one. Now this, as I said before, the visuality is almost completely the one of what later hieroglyphic writing would be. So we have these non-linguistic marking systems that function alongside other contemporaneous non-linguistic marking systems, and additionally that are on what retrospectively, because we are coming 5,000 years later, we can describe as a trajectory to what would ultimately become writing. But of course the actors in UJ know that they were doing something that later would be taken up to be transformed into writing. But then there's one major difference between this and the bookmarks, in simply visual terms, and namely that here the forms are vastly more iconic, they are more pictorial. And if you look at it into some details, you will see that there are many visually prestigious forms, like for example, on the left here, an emblem. So this is a non-linguistic marking system, but one with very high iconicity and one that mobilizes high prestige visual forms. So it's a very particular marking system, and therefore the next step is to look at what it means that there are all these prestigious, highly prestigious visual forms. So UJ, in the context of later fourth millennium elite visual culture, give you some examples. So you have the elephant atop the mountain, also on the tableau of the Wadi Magar. But then you have elephant atop various other things. It's visually the same kind of syntax, atop the intertwined snakes in the Sayala May set, in the Davis Room, in the Metropolitan Knife Factor. All very elite objects. Over here you have the same in yellow, in Jebel Shaouti 2 and Jebel Shaouti 28, so rock inscriptions. The same rock inscriptions also have in blue the scorpion that features so prominently on the jar inscriptions, as well as in green the falcon that features on the same jar inscriptions in UJ. Or if we start with a UJ if we start with the right, the Coptos Colossi, you have this bat emblem in blue, which recurs in the UJ tag. You have the min symbol, which recurs in the, so that's in brown in the UJ tags. You have the shells, possibly Red Sea shells, in green that recurs on the UJ jars, and you have again the elephant atop the mountain. So you see that the signs that are in UJ, they are part of a broader visual culture that is found in places like rock inscriptions, like combs, knife handles, very prestigious elite objects, and indeed the corpus colossi. There's a communication between these visual forms. Or here, that's a symbol sign that would later be it's a representation of the, what later is called the Perhur. You have it on this Herculis knife handle, but on the same you have the elephant atop the snakes again, which recurs on the Sayala mace handle, which has the Chabiro, which recurs on the UJ tag, which, and then again, slightly earlier in the street from the same necropolis. So again, there's this whole community, these visual forms, they communicate across artifacts and must therefore be interpreted in this context. Now there's a third element that needs to be considered, and these are the associated practices. First, the material production of the times. It has been noted first by Günter Dreyer and then by David Wenko that some of these tags actually have traces of having been cut across the signs, which implies that Not to mention there were large slabs of bone. All the attacks being done on these large slabs of bones, and then the slabs cut into pieces to make the small slabs, and sometimes, by the way, not cut quite right way, so that's how we can identify it. In practice, that means that many of these tanks were produced simultaneously on the same spot. In addition to this, there are many different paleographic hands that can be identified, implying that there were many people involved. So we have a situation where many people are involved in producing things on a single slab, simultaneously in the same place. In other words, this is a collective action of some sort. I put the word ritual because that's the easiest interpretation, but it's not the most important. It's a collective action of some sort with the tanks being produced very probably in abundance itself. And then these tanks are meant to be buried, which implies that they were meant to disappear. But of course, before disappearing, they would probably have been displayed. So there's this short time display before disappearance, and it's most probably a staged short time display before disappearance. Again, that points to a ritual dimension. If now I draw all these different pieces of evidence together, so what we have seen is the huge symbolic investment of these visual forms, which are the same, essentially, that you find in broader late 5th millennium visual culture on other types of artifacts, highly prestigious forms, carrying high cultural significations that are very difficult to reconstruct now, but must have been important to the people then. Then, what I began with, this huge material investment, the sumptuosity of the artifacts, remember the types that were filled with paste, or the extraordinary internal details of some of the inscriptions on the glass, the size fitted to the body of the vessel meant to be displayed, and what I just said about the associative practices, collective production, and stage disappearance after short time display. So if we take all of this together, what can it mean? Well, first, it's what we have is the practice of very literally marking objects, and here. Yeah, I'm aware that it's just a wordplay in English, but I mean, seriously, if you mark an object, you make the object. That is, an object does not exist only in an abstract sense. The fact of adding a mark onto the object that affects or alters the nature of the object can be phrased in different, more sophisticated ways. For example, David Wentrow here introduces the anthropology of branding. You're branding an object. I like that because it's awesome. It also makes a nice connection with our world. Or put differently, it adds to the object biography, to the life history of the object. Another way of putting it, by Pascal Vernus, you're adding semiotic luxury to the material luxury of the object. Even more luxurious. And quite probably because many of these signs are emblems and so forth, they have some religious association with all inverted commas, because I know nothing about first millennium religion, of course. But there must have been something of this, and that might have had some performative dimension. It was certainly there, but about which I cannot be more precise due to the lack of information. So that is one part, and the other part is, so we have most probably a collective picture, both of production and then of burying the objects, which objects are thereby manipulated and bear prestigious and highly restricted visual forms. So first there is an indexicality of power. Indexicality is simply the index you point to something. So it points to power because these forms are so restricted. And that of course goes hand in hand also with the iconic investment and the material investment of these forms. So there's a consumption of symbolic resources, mainly that these symbolic resources, the visual forms, are displayed and then made to be disappeared. And what is displayed and made to be disappeared is precisely what is so precious. The visual forms are rare, exclusive, and precious, just like the precious cloth or the imported goods in Zoom DJ would also have been. In other words, and here I'm playing on the Latin etymology, but I also mean it seriously, there's a consumption of the sumptuous. Meaning that if you have wealth and if you have power, first, you want to display it. And second, what is even better is you want to burn it. If you can burn the wealth and power you have, then you really have wealth and power. Therefore, it is quite important when we have these visual forms that end up in a barrier, that there is, literally a burning of what is among the most precious things they have at this time, namely the visual forms themselves. So that would have been about sorry about that. That would have been about UJ. If I just take 3 more minutes to sketch some slightly broader context, so this is about visual forms and the controlling of visual forms as indices of power, something extremely precious, rare, and exclusive, and therefore about early power itself. Slightly later, late dynasty zero, is it 50 years later, is it 150 years later, there's a chronological uncertainty living in the crisis. You have this feeling, which is really the first piece of what looks like hieroglyphic writing in the historical sense. And it is also actually readable for the first time. And just maybe 2 decades later, so that is Iriho, just before Narma. There are, of course, the Narma palettes. And the reason I'm quoting it here is that it's a good illustration, after all, of how simultaneously and on the same type of artifacts and directly tied to one another, you have the co-emergence of what, for example, ladies call the canonical tradition and hieroglyphic writing itself. And therefore, what Belkamp called formal culture. Now, formal culture in Belkamp's sense, I should say, was initially devised for architecture and secondarily for visual representation. I am extending it here to writing, but I think, and even this image shows it clearly, hieroglyphic writing itself is a component of this package that forms formal culture, and is therefore a very powerful index of formal culture. So that is for slightly later than UJ, but if I now go back to slightly before UJ, I would like to introduce a notion of evolution of simplicity, which has been introduced by actually Norman Yossi, an archaeologist and an anthropologist. Not speaking about Egypt, but I'm taking it to be used on Egypt. So the idea is when one thinks of trajectories towards statehood in general, one emphasizes the increased complexity of things. Social complexity, organizational complexity, urbanization, and why not right? But at the same time, there is and all of this is true, of course, but at the same time, there is also a simultaneous evolution where certain things, rather than becoming more complex, become actually more simple. A classical case in point is, for example, when Prussia became an integrated state in the 18th century after Christ, there was a simplification of weight and measures. Same thing I could say about the history of my country in the 19th century, Switzerland. So there's always, in this process of things becoming more complex, a simultaneous process of other things becoming more simple. Language standardization would be another issue on a completely different level. So here the point is, nevertheless, you have this painted pottery, decorated ware. Very few vessels are actually decorated, it's an elite thing, but still. There are several of these, and in Nagada 3 just disappears, and instead the pottery becomes undecorated. So in a sense, simpler. And the question is, where have all these visual forms gone? Where they have left pottery and gone to some other place, namely hard to work materials, and on which these visual forms are highly elaborated, and because these materials are so hard to work, how to get at, the visual forms become more highly restricted. And this is the exact context where you have the UJ inscriptions. Make the same argument in southern Mesopotamia in the later 5th and early 4th millennium, you have this absolutely beautiful decorated Ubaid pottery in northern Mesopotamia, simultaneously in Iran, the Susa 1 decorated pottery, which is beautiful. And by the later 4th millennium, all of this has disappeared. The painted ware has disappeared and is replaced by the so-called Babel Dream bowls, which are, as you can see, very coarse. Thousands of them have been found. They were mass-made or dispersing operations. But at the same time, the ideal operation of the complex iconography on other artifacts, for example, seals and, I'm sorry, the image is very bad, the Uruk base, as well as, and this is the very context, where disappears writing. So writing, both in Mesopotamia and in Egypt, appears in the context of what is, among other things, also an evolution of simplicity. And this evolution of simplicity means that there is a repertoire of visual forms, visual culture in the fourth millennium, that at some point is appropriated by the innermost elite. And in this appropriation, like in a bottleneck effect, elaborated further in most complex forms. So, by way of a conclusion on this, if we think about the early power, and you see that I'm using the term power and not state, because state has so many connotations that are dangerous, so I'm using the less committed term power, and what I would like to call the economy of the sign in late 4th millennium Egypt. Well, it's early power, to be sure, and I don't want to say that this is not the case, it's also based on force, it's based on the forceful appropriation of some selected resources, as well as on the control of some elements of long-distance circulation of goods. And here you have an example of obsidian from within tomb Bujay itself, which is a neat illustration of this. Then it is also, and that is just as important for early power, a matter of not only appropriating resources and goods, but also appropriating symbols. So there is an ideological appropriation of long-distance trade. In fact, the state, the early power did not control long-distance trade, but claimed to do so. So there is what David Wengrow called a moral economy of movement. It's completely ideological. And there is a symbolic appropriation of the territory, among other things, through these Hawking inscriptions. So that's the really recently discovered Nagel Hammadurai inscription near Aswan. Then there's, of course, control and elaboration of ritual, huge topic. And there is an ideological apparatus, so we are again in the symbolic realm. Just to take one example, and I'm taking this from Stan Hendricks, who discusses the social importance for the elite of hunting in the fourth millennium, which then gets ideologically transformed and synthesized into this idea of the containment of the unruly, the containment of the disorder that has to be repelled, and that has various manifestations, for example, the boundaries. The boundaries to begin with an ideological construction. The idea of the other, meaning the non-Egyptian, it's also an ideological construction, and what in later times is this whole mad effect complex, which is very fundamental. And here you have three examples that illustrate this evolution with increasingly abstract modes of symbolic representation. And that is the context which you have the evolution of simplicity I was talking about, and in which I propose that we have to understand the UJ inscriptions as well as writing when it later appears, namely an increasingly exclusive appropriation of symbolic and visual forms, first by the innermost elite and then essentially by the royal power itself. And here, there is of course a correlate. If the innermost elite and the king appropriates it, the visual culture in general becomes increasingly coarse, poor. Visual form becomes increasingly scarce across the country and across society. And to reinforce this exclusivity, an emphasis on how to work and how to obtain materials, and a massive elaboration of complexity of these visual forms. So, the general point is here that it was of vital importance for the early power to control not only certain material resources, but also symbolic forms and visual forms. That's what I call the economy of the sign, and that is the context in which I think we should be understanding these UJ inscriptions, and slightly later, when by the late dynasty zero, we have early writing. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah. tantissimo. Professor Stauder, per questa straordinaria esposizione. Penso veramente una conferenza di rottura, densa di 10.000 spunti di riflessione per tutti i possibili approcci. Quindi sono sicura che ci sono domande o curiosità, o anche semplicemente se qualcosa non è stata chiara. Penso appunto anche grazie al fatto che sono state capisce parlare in italiano, se volete chiedere chiarimenti su qualcosa, penso che sia molto disponibile. Oh. Sì, c'è.
Ho approfitto della sua conoscenza dell'italiano. Come archeologo preistorico, non egittologo, sono interessato ad aspetti che magari potrebbero sembrare secondari o banali. In questo caso, per esempio, mi interessa sapere, se ho capito bene, si tratta di produzioni destinate all'uso funerario soltanto e solo per un determinato uso, per un singolo uso. Perché dico questo? Il problema del foro delle tavolette è stato per caso studiato se può portare tracce di uso continuato, cioè di riutilizzazione, oppure diciamo se è in condizioni, cioè la tavoletta è in condizioni perfette, anche il foro lo è, significa che ha avuto un unico momento di produzione e un'unica destinazione. Però questo potrebbe già, secondo me, dare qualche informazione in più.
Non è stato studiato. Per quello riguarda le tablette.
Sì.
Per quel che riguarda quella web handle wear, c'è stata un'analisi di residui organici. Sono dato delle olie molto preziose e parte di portarti. Ma la cosa che è interessante è che...
Scusa, tanto, ma le tavolette sono in osso o in avorio anche?
C'è... il 20% è in avorio.
E già questo è significativo?
Sì, sì, perché se no deve portarti in avorio. Per il fatto che ci sono contenuti importati è stato più complicato perché la poteria stessa ha delle forme che ricordano delle produzioni delle banchine.
Sì, sì, credo.
Ma c'è stata un'analisi petrochimica che dimostra che infatti è una produzione locale, quindi è una produzione locale che fa come se fosse importata. Qui si vede tutto quel discorso del prestigio.
Però il vino doveva essere importato, credo, no?
Sì.
Credo senz'altro in quell'epoca.
Sì. C'è produzione di vino nel delta occidentale sin dalla prima dinastia, cioè 200 anni dopo.
Sì.
Iscrizioni.
Il primo input forse è quello.
Ma se c'è a questo periodo non si può, non si può dire.
Si può dire. Grazie.
Io in realtà ne avrei molte domande, però quella diciamo che mi interessa di più è, dato che comunque lei è un linguista, volevo chiedere come, siccome il sistema di scrittura geroglifico conserva sempre dell'iconicità in sé, non si evolve come ad esempio quello sumerico, diciamo. Lei comunque ha dimostrato molto efficacemente che la presenza di fonogrammi o di complementi fonetici non è così, diciamo, dimostrabile, neanche la presenza di determinativi, ma in sé come si può, cioè, a me pare che non si possa dire con certezza se un segno sia un logogramma o un semasiogramma per usare i termini.
Sì, rispondo alla tua domanda da cominciare. Sì, non ha ragione, non si può dire se è un logogramma o un semalogogramma in isolazione. Infatti la domanda non è nemmeno definita a questo livello, perché quando si dice logogramma si situa già in un sistema di scrittura, cioè in contrasto con fondamenti determinativi. Quando i determinativi non ci sono, quando i programmi non ci sono, dire che è un logogramma o dire che è un semogramma è la stessa cosa. Vedete che la definizione del logogramma stessa è relativa al fatto che ci siano quelle altre categorie di segni che non ci sono. E quindi abbiamo una situazione in cui si può vedere come una somatografia o si può leggere come un logogramma. La seconda alternativa, essendo, a mio parere, anacronistica, perché stiamo già leggendo come se fossimo nel fine della dinastia Zero. La prima parte della domanda, che richiede l'iconicità, qual era la domanda?
No, era semplicemente un dato che i segni sono comunque, hanno comunque un'apparenza molto iconica,
sì.
Quindi era riferito, era il ragionamento che poi portava
alla... L'iconicità ci rimane, la questione sarebbe quando entra il fanatismo. Una cosa di cui non ho parlato oggi, ma quello che penso è che ci siano due cose. La prima cosa è che dall'inizio, infatti ha a che fare con gli Ugeri, come io dico, dall'inizio questo segno UG è dopo la struttura della dinastia Zero, della dinastia Una, ha una enfasi fortissima sui nomi di dei, nomi di luoghi, nomi di re, nomi di persone. E nomi sono diversi da parole nel lessico, in quanto sono più difficili da rappresentare, forse non hanno un significato chiaro, un'etimologia trasparente, e quindi sono un posto ideale per lo sviluppo del fonetismo. Non sono in Egitto. E la ragione che se fa il paragone con la Mesopotamia, il fonetismo in Egitto è più rapido, è più intenso, e infatti il sistema è molto fonetico alla fine di una dinastia. E non lo è in Mesopotamia anche 500 anni dopo. Perché? Perché c'è quella, nel mio parere, enfasi fortissima sui nomi. Questa è la prima cosa. La seconda cosa è se torniamo aggiungo che già in New Jersey c'è quella enfasi su nomi, endemi, uomo. Cioè una cosa che comincia anche prima della prima classe. La seconda cosa è che se torniamo a quella sua interrogazione sulla differenza tra logogramma e semagiografia, infatti non c'è. Al tempo di Jay la stessa cosa è una semagiografia, il concetto stesso di logogramma non fa senso a quel gruppo perché è non definito. Comunque, se immaginiamo qualcosa di molto molto pratico, c'è la gente che sta monitorando questi segni. I segni non sono indirizzati sul muraggio, sulla catena, ma la gente non esiste. La gente parla. E anche questi segni, queste forme visuali, con i loro significati visuali, vengono trasmessi alla generazione seguente. Tutto quello si parla in linguaggio. Quindi abbiamo un setting in cui, manipolando questi segni, si parla. Cioè si fa un metadiscorso sui segni. E a quel punto, questi segni sono associati, praticamente, con il discorso parlato, e questo è un altro modo per il fonetismo per rientrare, per entrare in questo segno, semplicemente perché c'è gente concreta che parla.
Io
volevo proprio nell'ottica di questo passaggio, che poi sia una transizione o che sia, diciamo, più rapido, non saprei. Però volevo capire se possiamo dire in che percentuale segni che fanno parte, diciamo, del sistema di UJ sono poi passati dopo, o quanti sono invece i segni che muoiono, scompaiono, non vengono.
Sì, nelle tabellette ci sono 60 segni, più o meno la metà si ritrova nella struttura geopolitica storica, comunque non necessariamente nello stesso livello. Ma c'è quella continuità formale che è abbastanza importante, in realtà è importante. E un'altra ragione, io dico che non è scrittura, ma è un posto essenziale da studiare lo sviluppo della scrittura, perché appunto pochi decenni prima che c'è scrittura vera e propria, nei dipinti ci sono 10 segni, tra questi 10 segni c'è la metà che si ritrova nelle tavolette, quindi questi due sistemi comunicano tra loro, e c'è la metà che si ritrova dopo. Ovviamente il processo è molto graduale, ma non l'ho detto anche perché volevo fare l'enfasi sulla questione del potere, ma quello che tutto ciò significa è che non c'è un momento di rottura dove non c'è un tempo zero a cui si comincia a parlare di futuro. È graduale.
C'è qualche altra domanda?
Volevo fare una breve osservazione e poi una domanda. La breve osservazione riguarda il fatto che io sono anatolista, proprio di Anatolia antica, e stiamo affrontando un problema simile per quanto riguarda l'origine del geoglifico anatolico. Esattamente, anche nei cocci di vasi, dei frammenti di vasi di età tendenzialmente passiva. Ultimamente, parlo proprio degli ultimi 3-4 anni, sono usciti dei lavori in cui si tenta di raggiungere questi segni, che sono pochissimi e isolati, delle forme di scrittura originale da cui si evolverebbe il sistema geoglifico, però di fatto io credo che effettivamente ci sia un po' questo fenomeno dell'ethos della decifrazione, come diceva lei, cioè si cerca di trovare la scrittura glottografica anche dove non ce n'è realmente traccia, e probabilmente l'interpretazione appunto di una rappresentazione visuale del potere da parte di un'elite è molto applicabile in questo caso, perché noi troviamo questi segni in Anatolia, nei vasi e nei sigilli delle elite locali che probabilmente si opponevano all'iconografia invece Assiria, delle colonie paleo-Assiria, quindi probabilmente è un parallelismo che si può tracciare, molto interessante. Poi volevo chiedere una cosa che non ho capito molto bene. Lei ha fatto riferimento alla mobility of population, questa società molto arcaica. Non so immaginare esattamente a cosa si possa riferire, cosa vuol dire.
Il fatto è che ci sono vari modi di produzione di cibo. Il pastoralismo è importante, specie nella parte ovest del paese. Rimane importante fino al secondo millennio. È una cosa che è stata un po' trascurata nel passato dall'egittologia, ma che emerge adesso. Era soltanto questo. I confini, per esempio il confine occidentale è molto poroso. Il fatto che ci sia un confine è una costruzione ideologica, intanto la popolazione libica muove nell'ovest dell'Egitto e viceversa. Per il paragone con l'anatomico geografico, sì, a me piace moltissimo. La mia impressione è che abbiamo appunto questo non-linguistic mapping system che evolve per diventare una struttura. Tutte le altre cose, essendo magari diverse, quello è la stessa caccettura che fa il proprio piano, c'è la Perché c'è quella continuità visuale quando si vede Magnus Rex, si legge Magnus Rex, anche se è isolato, è un tempo dove non c'è ancora la scrittura, e c'è anche il fatto dei sigilli, che è molto importante per i sigilli, è un modo di distribuire marche. Cioè, tutto quello che stavo dicendo su marking objects, naming objects, è un modo di distribuire segni a livello più elementare. E prima di essere un modo di controllare qualsiasi cosa. Quindi a me va molto, è un'altra cosa che dimostra un ambiente anatolico diverso da quello egitto, cioè che un non linguistic mapping system che può sviluppare per diventare una scrittura propria può essere di interesse per il potere, anche se c'è già un'altra scrittura, quello che non abbiamo ovviamente in forza di legno, cioè c'è quella specialità funzionale, che è molto chiaro. Magari è l'altro per fare lì.
Sì. Scusi, volevo fare un ulteriore pensamento su vari rapporti fotografici dei segni, sia egizi e sia nei segni dei vari simboli che troviamo in Museo 80. Lei ha fatto vedere il periodo principale in caso di U, la base delle Anna. Ecco, vicino, infatti, conoscendolo bene, ho visto che ci sono alcuni segni, tra cui a parte che è strutturata una immagine della terra, della flora e della fauna, no? che c'erano all'epoca di Sumer e che sono dedicati tutta la dea Inanna. No? E infatti vicino a Inanna, alla dea di Inik, no? Delle Anna, vi sono anche il simbolo N, che è quello delle teastiche, che troviamo anche in una maniera analoga, anche come diciamo un feticcio arcaico che diventa anche un simbolo nella scrittura geroglifica, perché vediamo cosa. Ecco, ne volevo chiedere, in base a questo apprezzamento che lei ha visto, ha fatto anche soprattutto questi elementi fantastici, no? Dei segni. Ecco, i due leoni che diciamo che si affrontano, no? Sulla tra voletta che troviamo che rappresentano altri bassi Egitto, no? E rappresentano le terre che sono diciamo controllate ora dal potere del faraone che ha unificato. Ecco, hanno uno stesso significato anche in Mesopotamia, sapendo che sono bestie arabiche che si ritrovano già anche in iconografia mesopotamica, o è sempre lo stesso?
Se ho ben capito la sua domanda,
sì, complesso.
Sì, perché è molto dimensionale, infatti. Non c'è tanta continuità tra le forme visuali stesse. Quello che si può paragonare è ovviamente il fatto che anche in Mesopotamia c'è un lessico iconografico che poi va investito nella scrittura. L'esempio più chiaro questo sono gli emblemi. Riferisco a Krasinska o Michalowski. Ci sono quegli emblemi che all'inizio non fanno parte della scrittura, sono appunto una rappresentazione delle marche che vengono reinvestite come segni di scrittura. E tipologicamente abbiamo lo stesso sviluppo in Egitto. E di emblemi ce ne sono stati parecchi. Ci sono alcune formule iconografiche di apparenza mesopotamica nel quarto millennio in Egitto.
Sì.
E le formule ovviamente hanno una origine straniera, ma quello che per me è anche più importante di diciamo, l'etimologia di queste forme è come vengono associate con un altro significato. Quando vengono adoperate in una sintassi visuale egiziana. caso classico è la Rosetta, che si trova a Susa, e poi si trova due volte sui monumenti di Narnia, e anche prima di questo c'è una Rosetta, per esempio, sulla Rosetta di Narnia, potremmo dire, significa. Il significato non è lo stesso, e quella cosa per la rappresentazione simmetrica è veramente un po' un controllo del caos in un senso molto specifico all'Egitto, direi. E quello che è interessante anche è che in queste forme che hanno origine estranea, come la Rosetta, ma anche le forme simmetriche, ce n'è, non so se. C'era qua, ce n'è una, quelle forme simmetriche a Luce stessa, vengono soppresse dal sistema scientifico quando emerge, cioè c'è un riconoscimento che queste forme in un certo senso non fanno parte della cultura visuale proprio, e poi li fanno sparire. Comunque è un dettaglio. Non so se risponde a ho risposto alla sua domanda.
Ma era assai chiaro, vuol dire.
Vediamo se lo trovo qua. Sì, ma non si vede, infatti questo qua dovete immaginare c'è la stessa
rappresentazione
che si mette. Questo è un tipo visuale che nel periodo storico lo sparisce in Egitto, questo trovo molto interessante, che significa che non sono io a dire, che loro stessi hanno l'esperienza di magari non sanno che hanno origine estranea, ma hanno la coscienza visuale che non è la
loro.
Qualche altra domanda?
Just first remark. I found very fascinating and stimulating the idea of the appropriation of the elite of the symbol of gold and the contemporary evolution of simplicity. I can't see very much the connection. I mean, I see there is. It's kind of evident. It's like empirical. But I can't see how the elite appropriate from a lower strata this kind of iconography, and then the lower strata of society like felt, okay, we need to reduce the simplicity of this iconography. So I mean, it's something that must be studied. I don't know if you have developed any idea about this.
Very promising, because they empty the country. How do they do it? Of course, it goes over centuries, so it's a process. What I imagine is practically that it must have to do with getting control of a workmanship to some extent. Mm-hmm. So, to appropriate forms, and to some extent, you also need to appropriate a piece of wood. But that, of course, it was millennium, so it's dark. Here we have to model. It's very difficult to answer your question directly. But I see your point. You want to have it practical.
Yeah, I mean, I see that. I mean, the painted vases and vases with description are all over the country. So I mean, I see that it's connected. I mean, I see perfectly what you mean. So I like very much this idea. I just think we should work more on this, because it's very fascinating, but I see how the mechanism of social control can work.
It's a classical bottleneck effect that has been studied in the social sciences and anthropology, for example, by people like Sperman, but évaluer les consciences sociales, for Eastern societies. And it often goes with the invention of writing, including the invention of alphabetic writing in non-literate societies nowadays. So that I can study it empirically, and one of the questions is, of course, would it make sense to transpose the results or the models that are derived from these modern day archaeological studies and project them into the very deep past. I don't know. But they at least have access to empirical data which might be relevant at a level that would be sufficiently abstract.
Utilissima osservazione mia.
Volevo sapere se il quadro degli altri ritrovamenti, gli altri oggetti trovati nella tomba, si collega a questo discorso appunto della rivoluzione della semplicità e dello strumento della produzione del potere, cioè gli altri oggetti funerari sono coerenti con questo quadro oppure non danno altri dati?
Sì, sì, sono molto, molto, molto coerenti, perché c'è, per esempio l'ossidianus deve prendere lontano, è molto esclusivo, c'è oro, ci sono simboli del potere. In un certo senso quello che dico è che quando c'è quell'oggetto in ossidianus, e poi c'è un oggetto con segni visuali, è la stessa pratica, c'è quello che è esclusivo e che viene bruciato perché per poter dimostra la capacità di bruciare ciò che è molto esclusivo. Quindi è coerente con quello che c'è. Sì, questo è un problema empirico, quello che si vede molto basso non si vede molto. Per esempio al Tel El Tafra, nel delta orientale, hanno trovato posti dove si fabricava la birra. Si fabricava en masse, è una fabbricazione massiccia, che va ovviamente molto bene con quell'idea che c'è una massificazione della produzione a certi posti, illustrata per esempio dal Berlin Books di nuovo, la ceramica molto greggia. Sono cose che non sono state studiate molto nel passato perché l'egittologia non era tanto interessante. Adesso che si guarda queste cose, si trova l'indice di produzione massiccia.
E quando parla di bruciare, parli intende in senso metaforico.
Sì.
No, mi era venuto il dubbio. Hanno anche bruciato qualcosa. Mi sembrava strano.
No, ma c'è per esempio il discorso del sacrificio umano.
Sì, sì.
Proprio quello che è interessante è che.
È quello che viene sacrificato, diciamo.
Proprio all'inizio, quando il potere si costituisce, il potere deve dimostrare che inizia a fare il sacrificio quello che
è più persona. Succede anche nella protettoria europea, questo.
E poi sparisce.
È ben conosciuto.
Sul discorso del burning in senso metaforico, ovviamente, io volevo fare una domanda. Fino a che punto possiamo usare questo argomento per la teoria interessantissima e che con cui sono assolutamente d'accordo che ha risposto? Nel momento in cui non sappiamo che cosa pensassero del destino post-mortem, e in realtà noi possiamo supporre che loro immaginassero la vita eterna di chi era seppellito in un genio. Quindi non era un burning, era al contrario il massimo uso, quindi forse poteva anche avere scopi pratici.
Ma direi che tutta quella cosa religiosa non possiamo sapere. Quando vedo quelle fonti, sono emblemi. Mi immagino che anche fare un po' anche quello, solo che non posso precisare. Comunque non sono due cose esclusive. È molto importante di avere quelle cose più preziose per il tema. E allo stesso tempo al momento di fare il sacrificio è una costruzione molto distorta. Qua andare insieme, sono sei due livelli diversi.
C'è lo stento.
Però se io immagino che in qualche forma quella persona continui a vivere, può anche avere un uso dogmatico, non soltanto simbolico, era questo, no?
Sì, sì. Quello che dicevano. Sì, sono il simbolico da fare la fondazione per parlare. Sì, ma sono assolutamente d'accordo, solo che non lo voglio entrare.
Cioè, no, è un terreno. Beh, io direi, andiamo a mangiare questa strada.